This certainly has to be the most joyous moment of my life. The immense pleasure I, Vishwamitra, feel just looking at the lotus-like face of Rama far exceeds the joy I felt when I was declared a Brahma Rishi after intense austerities. Rama has kindly accepted me as his servant, despite my vain arrogance. I have been able to joyfully render service to him. His presence has unlocked a door for me that I should have opened a long time ago. Now, only one service remains before I can walk through that open door into the eternal realm of perfection. Tomorrow, I shall fulfill this last responsibility. Their eternally united paths first seemed to cross as Rama, Lakshman, and I walked through the busy lanes of Mithila. Who is this hypnotizing beauty? Why do I feel so attracted to her? His gaze makes my heart restless. I feel awkward, yet cannot help being attracted to him. Could he be the one?
Rama, Lakshman, hurry up! We're getting late! Rise for the Lord of Mithila, Maharaj Janaka.
Oh, great sage, I'm honored by your presence in my court today. What brings you here?
Oh, king, I've come here desiring to show the bow of Lord Shiva that is in your possession to my disciples.
Rama and Lakshman, the sons of Maharaj Dasharatha of Ayodhya. The legendary bow is so great that no tales or descriptions could do justice to it.
It would be my pleasure to show you the bow, dear sage. But before that, I wish to tell you the story of the bow.
Long ago, Vishwakarma constructed two bows of unlimited strength and presented one each to Lord Vishnu and Lord Shiva. The idol demigods wished to test which of the two bows were stronger. So they approached and convinced Lord Brahma to arrange a duel between Lord Shiva and Lord Vishnu.
A terrible fight ensued. It was so fierce that the existence of the universe itself came under threat. Realizing their folly, the demigods pitifully requested the lords to stop the contest. The lords relented.
At a later time, Daksha, the father of Lord Shiva's wife, insulted him by not inviting him to a grand yagya he was performing. Sati went to her father's yagya anyway, but was humiliated by Daksha, and she left her body there. An enraged Lord Shiva came and threatened to sever the head of Daksha, his father-in-law, with the same bow. He stopped, only because the demigods begged forgiveness and pacified him. He gave the bow away to them at their request. The demigods, in their turn, gave the bow to King Devavrata, the sixth descendant of King Nemi, the founder of my dynasty. And since then, the royal family of Mithila has the bow in its possession. O sage, the mighty bow lies safe in a room where it is being worshipped every day.
Guards, bring in that most wondrous bow. The bow had been kept on a gigantic cart, which had to be pulled by 500 bulls to move it. And it took 5,000 of his army men with elephant-like bodies and rock-solid arms to push the cart into the courtroom. How gigantic the bow was, and how beautiful! It was almost as though a huge rainbow had fallen off the sky and was waiting to be lifted.
My dear guest, no one has been able to lift this bow, not even the great demigods, Gandharvas or Kinaras. I have perhaps been a fool to put forward such a hard condition for my daughter's hand. Maybe if Ram could be convinced to lift the bow, it will be proven
that I wasn't such a fool after all. Dear sage, when I first announced that anyone who could lift the bow could win my daughter Sita's hand in marriage, hundreds of princes, kings, demigods lined up to try. But alas, not one of them could even budge the bow. Feeling insulted, they banded together and attacked Mithila. I somehow managed to counter their attack with the help of the demigods. But that barely solved my original concern. Sita, the dear princess of Mithila, the most beautiful and able girl in the entire world, still languishes without a suitable groom.
Within his heart, I knew that Maharaj Janaka desperately wanted Rama to lift the bow and win Sita's hand. I sat, waiting for him to spell out his desire.
O great Vishwamitra, deep within my heart, I still believe that the precondition I have set for Sita's wedding is not impossible. I'm hoping that the precondition will easily be fulfilled by the one who would be a perfect match for her. Vishwamitra, your disciple Ram is well qualified. If he could lift the bow, I would gladly offer my daughter in marriage to him.
This was the moment I had been waiting for. It would be my pleasure to let him try, O King.
I somehow cannot forget the beautiful girl I saw staring out of the framed window. Well, I hope she is the one I'm doing this for.
Janaka was ecstatic. The majestic bow of Lord Shiva, the pride of Mithila, had not just been lifted, it had been snapped in half. He sent for Sita.
Sita, this is the happiest day in my life!
Mine too!
Sita, what's wrong with you?
Is she okay?
I don't know.
Huh?
What?
God, sister! Get up, let's go!
Go?
Go where?
Prayer? Did you not hear the bowl break?
Look at her! She's not just lost, she seems to have gone deaf too. The sound reached all corners of the universe, but not Sita's ears, although she was just a few yards away. Sita, stop pretending!
We got a glimpse of him.
He is as effulgent as a thousand suns.
Who are you talking about?
That's enough, Sita. Now hear loud and clear. Prince Rama, the son of King Dashrath of Ayodhya, just broke Lord Shiva's bow and fulfilled the condition our father set for your marriage.
And that means that you're getting married.
So, let's get you ready quickly. Ankh wants you in the court immediately.
So, this day is finally here. It's really happening. I really hope he's the one I saw. Oh, those feet. They're the same strong feet I saw from my window.
It is her, the mystic beauty who captivated me by the palace window. I can't believe this is happening.
The sight of Lord Rama and Sita beholding each other was captivating. But things were not meant to be settled at that moment.
But wait. What am I doing? How can I, the son of Dasharath, the upholder of principles, marry without my father's permission? My father sent me with Vishwamitra to assist him. I came here to see the bow because my spiritual master instructed me to. Marriage was not at all on my agenda. O king, I can't marry her without my father's approval.
I know you all must be thinking that Sita must have been heartbroken at Rama's apparent refusal. This was not the case at all. Rather, she was delighted.
Rama had already shown his valor by breaking the bow, but now he was displaying two more very important qualities that Sita desired in a husband, prudence and respect, which he showed in his dealings with her father, and self-control, which he showed by placing principle over desire. Not worry, O King. Rama has only acted on his principles. Dispatch your most trusted messengers to Ayodhya immediately with the wedding proposal, and I assure you that you will not be disappointed.
Presenting a messenger from Mithila, the kingdom of Maharaj Janaka.
Tell me, dear messenger, is my friend Janaka doing well? Are his citizens happy and peaceful?
Maharaj Dasharath, always well in the kingdom of Mithila, I bring to you delightful news not just of King Janaka, but of your glorious sons, Ram and Lakshmana, as well.
The messenger then went to describe the glorious act of Rama and Lakshmana in the forest. How they killed the demon Tataka. How they helped me complete my yajna. And how Rama redeemed Ahalya, the wife of sage Gautama. He spoke of our journey to Mithila and told Dasharath of the breaking of the bow.
What glorious news you bring, O messenger! Yes, I heard the tumultuous sound of the bow breaking too!
My lord, I have brought you more delightful news that will make the whole of Ayodhya jubilant.
This cannot be happening. It's a dream coming true. A marriage proposal from my dear Ram, from Janaka?
Yes, dear king. I know what you are thinking. This alliance would be very beneficial for both Ram and Ayodhya.
Let the celebrations begin!
Dasharath donated profusely across his kingdom to share his joy, and he invited every citizen of Ayodhya to the wedding. His citizens were warmly welcomed by the citizens of Mithila. The wedding was the only thing on everyone's mind.
Dear Mitra, your Sita is certainly so fortunate to marry our prince. I'm sure she will need 1,000 pair of eyes to absorb all the beauty of our Ram.
Seems to me that you haven't seen our princess yet. Once you see Sita, I'm sure you'll realize that it is Rama who needs 1,000 pair of eyes to see Sita. No, I don't think that's enough to see the one whose feet have never touched the earth. And who is so graceful that she can even put a swan to shame. No, no, Rama, he'll need 1,000 pair of eyes at it every minute to properly admire her beauty. And yes, yes, I agree that Sita is so beautiful too.
When Rama and Sita stand together, I get confused who to look at. Rama or Sita? Rama, Sita, Rama, Sita.
Yeah, I know what you mean. I am so scared I'll turn cockeyed from the whole exercise. So I just close my eyes, and then I can see both Rama and Sita together in my heart. I simply stay that way.
You can stay that way if you like. I'm going. I do not want to miss the wedding festival.
Hey, wait for me. I'm coming too.
The wedding was the greatest event of the time, a grand union of solar and lunar dynasties. The festivities quadrupled. Rama's brothers married the three other princesses of Mithila. Lakshman married Sita's sister, Urmila, and Bharat and Shatrughna respectively married Mandavi and Shrutakirti, the daughters of Janaka's brother, Kushadwaja.
Ram. She's now your Sita. She has been raised to be an ideal queen and an ideal wife. One who will follow you like a shadow when you choose the right path and not hesitate to correct you if you stray. She will be your companion in both good times and bad. Please take care of her and protect her properly.
It will be my pleasure, dear father. And on this day, I take the vow of monogamy. I bequeath myself entirely and exclusively to Sita.
You may now exchange garlands.
I can confidently say that I was the happiest member of the wedding party. It wasn't just a marriage or the meeting of two great dynasties. It was the joy of surrender. I was now free. Free from the burden of knowledge and powers I had acquired as a Brahmarishi. Free from all my responsibilities. Free to finally enter the door Rama had unlocked for me. The door that would lead me to perfection.
Do you like our ad-free videos? Be sure to subscribe to our channel. We publish new videos every day, and don't forget to like and share our channel.